Ini dalam bahasa Inggris ya?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, good morning everybody, everyone. Yeah. Today we will have Dr. Yudis. He will present the journal, yeah? Department journal. With the title is Clinical and Polysomnographic Predictors of Laryngopharyngeal Reflux in Obstructive Sleep Apnea Syndrome. Okay, Dr. Yudis, you have your time. Yeah. You can present your PowerPoint.
Thank you, Dokter. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning for all supervisor, Dr. Faroka ENT Specialist Consultant, Dr. Kanti Unika ENT Specialist Consultant, and Dr. Nur Iman ENT Specialist, and all fellow resident, my friend. Today I will present it about my journal department about clinical and polysomnographic predictors of laryngopharyngeal reflux in obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. First of all, from the abstract, the introduction, this journal tells the obstructive sleep apnea syndrome and laryngopharyngeal reflux are diseases with high prevalence in overall population. The objective is to evaluate and determine the prevalence of the laryngopharyngeal reflux or LPR in patients with moderate and severe obstructive apnea syndrome and determine its predictive factors. The method of this journal is historical cohort cross-sectional study of patients age 18 years old until 70 years old. Refer to a tertiary service of otorhinolaryngology outpatient clinic with a polysomnographic diagnosis of moderate or severe obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. The reflux symptoms index questionnaire and the reflux finding score at indirect video laryngoscopy were applied. And the result, but 56 patients were evaluated. 64.3% had a positive laryngopharyngeal reflux or LPR, is positive RSI and or positive endolaryngeal or RFS. The body mass index was a predictor of reflux present in this group of a patient with moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. In patient with positive score for endoscopic finding and RSI 12.3%, and there was a trend towards significance for higher mean apnea hypopnea index and higher percentage of sleep time with O2 saturation below 90%, about p equal than 0.05. In the conclusion, the prevalence of laryngopharyngeal reflux was higher in this group of patients with moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. And the body mass index was the predictor of laryngopharyngeal reflux in this patient. There was a trend toward greater oxyhemoglobin desaturation in this patient with a positive score for RSI and RFS. The introduction, the OSAS or obstructive sleep apnea syndrome and LPR or laryngopharyngeal reflux are conditions with high prevalence in the general population, affecting 20 until 40% of adult population. The both have significant impact on quality of life and lead to increased morbidity in affected individuals. The obesity also considered as one of the main factor for the increasing intra-abdominal pressure. The method of this journal is clinical cross-sectional study of historical cohort of patients aged 18 to 70 years. Refer to a tertiary service otolaryngology outpatient clinic with a PSG diagnosis of moderate to severe OSAS. According to the criteria of the last international classification of sleep disorder. The method using the polysomnography was EMBLAS S7000 with monitoring of electroencephalogram, electromyogram, electrocardiogram, and airflow, respiratory effort, saturation oxyhemoglobin, snoring, and body position. The exclusion criteria, the patient using PPIs or proton pump inhibitor or gastric medication in past 30 days, patient submitted to previous esophageal surgery, those with decompensated clinical and or psychiatric disease, user alcohol or other psychoactive substances, user of sedative medication that could alter esophageal tone, and patient with neuromuscular disease were excluded. and the patient who were already using continuous positive airway or CPAP therapy for last 3 months were also excluded. In the questionnaire, the using the reflux symptom index or RSI and reflux finding score or RFS were always applied by the same examiner after indirect laryngoscopy performed. The examination was always performed by two laryngologists who joined a score for each parameter considered the RFS score. The maximum time between polysomnography and clinical evaluation with the use of this questionnaire and indirect laryngoscopy was 6 months. An individual who had scored more than 13 in RSI questionnaire and also scored more than 7 in RFS scale according to the original description of the score were considered is having a RPR. This is the reflux symptom index or RSI. We can count the patient score. The first we get the hoarseness or problem with the voice, the point between 0 until 5. If they have a severe problem, they must scoring in 5. The first hoarseness of the problem on the voice, the second is clearing the throat, and the third excuse throat mucus or post nasal drip, and next the difficulty swallowing food, coughing after the 8 hours after lying down, and breathing difficulties or choking episode, and troublesome of or annoying cough, sensation of smoking stick in your throat, and heartburn, chest pain, and indigestion or stomach acid coming up. And this is the reflux finding score or RFS. We using if the positive, the value must be more than 7. We can get the subglottic edem, 0 absent or 2 point is a patient. Ventricle obliteration is also partial 2 point and complete 4 point. Erythema or hyperemia if arytenoid only 0.2 and diffuse 4 point. And focal cord edema, we can get the mild, moderate, severe, and polypoid. And then diffuse laryngeal edem, mild, moderate, severe, and obstructive. And also posterior commissure hypertrophy, mild, moderate, severe, and obstruction. And also granulation tissue, absent or present. And thick endolaryngeal mucus, absent or present. Hello. Statistical analysis. The statistical analysis was performed using the SPSS program. The Kolmogorov Smirnov test was used to verify the normality of variable. Levien test was used to verify the homogeneity of the variable between the groups. Pearson correlation was performed for the preliminary analysis. Logistic regression models were used for the analysis of reflux predictor or LPR. And the concomitant present of RFS and RSI. And the categorical variable were represented by relative frequency, and the chi-square test was used to compare the group. And the result of a total 59 patients were evaluated, of which 33.9% were female and 66.1% were male. 3 patients were excluded from the statistical analysis due to lack of data. And considering of criterion of positivity for laryngopharyngeal reflux, the score more than 13 in RSI, 2 or more than 7 in RFS. And it also was verified that the presentation of the patient with positive RSI was 37.9% and the presentation of patient with RFS was 38.6%. There is no statistically significant difference were found in the clinical and polysomnographic parameters assessed in the groups of patients who score positively and negatively for laryngopharyngeal reflux in RSI and RFS questionnaire. When comparing the groups of patients with and without laryngopharyngeal reflux according to the criterion positive RSI or RFS, it was observed that body mass index was higher with statistically significance. In P equal 0.03 in the group of patients with reflux in table 1, and was also higher with statistical significance in group of patients who score positively in both tools in P equal 0.02. In this table 1, from the body mass index, the P is according to the journal this journal is P0.03. With the journal, it is below 0.05. And also in table 2, we get the P0.05 in AHI score and the percentage of saturation of hemoglobin. And the result in this group of patients who had positive RSI and RFS, 12.5% simultaneously, where there was a trend towards significant or P equal 0.05. For the higher apnea and hypopnea index and higher percentage of sleep time with oxyhemoglobin saturation below 90%. And the logistic regression show that body mass index was a predictor factor for the presence of RPR in table 3. In patient with moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea syndrome with an increase in the risk of having reflux is about 30% higher in patient with increasing on body mass index. And however, no predictor were identified when evaluating the presence of RPR according to the criteria of both positive RSI and RFS tools. And this is for the table 3, the predictor of RPR, the positive RSI or RFS. It tells the body mass index is P0.016. And the table 4 is for predictor for positive RFS and RSI. It tells about the many factor that use in positive RFS and RFS, their age, body mass index, gender, and apnea hypopnea index and saturation. And the discussion, the gastroesophageal reflux or GERD is high prevalence condition in the overall population and defined as symptoms and or complication cause the return of gastric and duodenal content to the esophagus and the upper aerodigastric tract. Among the esophageal symptoms of GERD is sleep disturbance, chest pain, coughing, throat clearing, asthma, and dental erosions. This is the initial difference between RPR and GERD. The first symptoms, many patients with RPR do not have dyspepsia. Common symptoms include throat clearing, globus pharyngeus, halitosis, and prolonged vocal warm-up, and the frequent sore throats, chronic cough, asthma, among the others. And then symptoms periodically, the patient with RPR have intermittent symptoms, which are often not daily. And then the RPR episode of daytime reflux and the upright position, and GERD have reflux episode during the night and the supine position. And the physiopathogen, the RPR is related to dysfunction of upper esophageal sphincter, and the GERD is related for the lower esophageal sphincter. And then RPR usually requires higher dose of PPI to control symptoms in relation of GERD. Discussion, the use of combined impedance pH monitoring has been recommended as more accurate diagnostic method, although it is not the patient will have reflux. The episode sufficient for the diagnosis during monitoring, while very often originally related to life habits that were not present during the examination. There is no gold standard for the diagnosis of RPR or agreement between the diagnostic method. We consider the fact that the patient in our study didn't undergo combined the impedance pH monitoring for a comparative purpose limiting factor for the study. And the 25 patients with diagnosis of RPR by a double probe pH monitoring were evaluated before treatment and 6 months after use PPI administered in 2 daily dose and compared with group of 25 individuals in the control group without the diagnosis of RPR. The RSI score on the RPR group after 6 months of the treatment was statistically significantly close the score in the control group and the consistency of asymptomatic individual. The mean of RSI score is 11.6 or 95%. In our study, the percentages of patients with positive RSI was 37.9% with also a score 13.7. And from original study, 40 patients diagnosed of LPR confirmed by double probe pH monitoring were initially evaluated through RFS, as well as after 2, 4, and 6 months of treatment with PPI and compare with control group of 40 asymptomatic subjects submitted to RFS. The score were calculated by two independent and blind laryngologists in the original study. The mean RFS for the individual in this group, control group, was 5.2 or 95%. The conclusion of the study is that the individual with RFS score is more than 7, there is 95% certainly of diagnosis of LPR. In this study, the percentage of patients with positive RFS was 38.6% and the mean score was 6.9. The fact that the video laryngoscopy analysis performed by two independent laryngologists who were blind or submit to pair analysis a limiting factor in this study. And then the RSI questionnaire was patient dependent only, and also because percentage found between positive RSI 37.9% and positive RFS 38.6% were very similar in our study. We believe that this finding may be even close to the reality in patients with OSAS, unlike the other previous study that show higher percentage of this data. Also considering a positive diagnosis of LPR with only one positive tool using RFS or RSI, as well as the result of the original validation study by these tools, by Belfasky et al. And in national study of 105 patients, an association was found higher between higher RSI score and apnea severity in obese patients, BMI more than 30 kilo per meter cubic. The conclusion of the study was that obese patients with moderate or severe OSAS have more severe symptoms than one obese patient. As for non-obese patient, LPR and OSAS are independent factor giving the similar RSI score. Another study with 24-hour double probe PH monitoring in OSAS patients showed that both the number and duration of reflux episode during sleep significantly correlated with the apnea severity. This research are in agreement with finding of our study. And regarding the clinic and PSG parameter evaluated in our study, it was observed that body mass index was higher with statistical significance in the group of patients with LPR, at the same time being predictor of presence of reflux in patients with OSAS. And it found that prevalence of LPR was significantly higher in obese patients, its body mass index more than 30 kilos per meter cubic, and that the significant difference in inflammatory signs suggestive of reflux between obese and non-obese subjects suggested that obese may interfere the inflammatory finding in pharynx and larynx. And then the apnea and hypopnea index or AHI and percentage of time with oxyhemoglobin saturation below 90% were not identified as predictor of reflux in the SS patient, but they show to be parameter with borderline significant or p equal 0.05 in the comparison between the group patient who show positive RSI or RFS. And it is possible that patient with a positive score in both tools that assess reflux have more severe form of LPR, and this patient trend towards greater desaturation of oxyhemoglobin was observed, which suggests that more severe form of reflux may be predisposed by greater severe of OSAS. In the conclusion, it can be concluded that the occurrence of the LPR in patients with OSAS was higher in comparison to previous population studies, and that the higher body mass index was a predictor of the presence of reflux in this patient. There was a trend toward greater oxyhemoglobin desaturation in patients with positive score in both in reflux finding score and the reflux symptom index tools. And the critical appraisal, are this study valid? Yes. Is this number of sample available in number of from start to finish? Yes. Can this study be continued? Yes. In this research useful? Yes. In this research applicable to the patient? Yes. And this study affect patient or action or therapy? Yes. And in this research beneficial? Yes. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Yudis. Now we have Dr. Rahma as a content reviewer.
Yeah. Dr. Nurima, Dr. Kanti, and Dr. Farofah, and all residents for the chance given to me to comment for this journal, to review for this journal. Thank you, Dr. Judith, for explaining this journal. This is one of the good journal, and you explain it very complete by this journal. I have two questions for Dr. Yudis related to this journal. First question, in this journal, it is mentioned that using PSG or polysomnography examination, using APNO hypopno index or AHI score to diagnose the degree of severity in OSAS. Can you explain, please, how about the AHI classification? The item of AHI classification. And then the second question. We know that the gold standard for LPR is a pH monitoring, 24-hour pH monitoring to diagnose the LPR. But you mentioned before that pH monitoring for LPR is one of limitation of this journal. So did the author mention before patient with LPR by RSI and RFS score got therapy before such a PPI test or only diagnose the LPR by scores of RSI and RFS?
Clear enough, Dr. Yudis?
Okay. Yeah. Thank you for the question from Dr. Rahma. I will try to answer the question. The first question is about the APNO hypopno index in polysomnographic examination. The first of all, the APNO hypopno index is used to indicate the severity of sleep apnea. It is represented by a number of the apnea and hypopnea event per hour during the sleep. For the criteria itself, it contain four criteria. The first is normal if the apnea hypopnea index is below than 5. If and the second is mild sleep apnea is the index was the point is 5 until 15. And the moderate sleep apnea is the value is between 15 to 30, and the severe of sleep apnea is the score of the apnea hypopnea is more than 30. For second question,
for the apnea and hypopnea, is there any duration for each of the events?
When we it counts of the apnea hypopnea in 1 hour, doctor. In one hour, hour, we can account when the patient has apnea and hypopnea in 1 hour, and we can conclusion the value, and we get the numbers.
It's hour, and how about the duration of apnea and hypopnea?
The duration of
many seconds.
About the apnea, it's at least 10 seconds.
10 seconds, yeah. Thank you, sir. More detail about the explanation about AHI. Okay.
And for the second question, from this journal is tells they only use the they use the criteria using the RSI and RFS only. But in generally for the LPR itself, it can be diagnosed for the pH monitoring. But in this journal, they is not using the pH monitoring because the author says that only using the RSI and RFS only, it can get the original validation without using the pH monitoring. So they used only criteria for IVR in using RSI and RFS.
Oke, Dokter Rahma.
Yes,
is it clear enough or you got any question? More question about this, you know? Yeah. Enough. Okay.
And the second question is, I think we cannot explain more than this because the author mentioned before that this is the one of the limitation.
A lot of background noise, yeah. You have a lot of animals. You have a lot of animals in your home.
I'm sorry that.
And Dr. Yudis, can you explain what is apneas in does it means and hypopneas definition for the definition of apneas and hypopneas?
Oh yes, Dok. Definition of the apnoe and hypopneo index, Doctor.
Yeah, for the definition only about what is apneas, yeah.
The apneas, it means the pause in breathing.
Pause in breathing, yeah, okay.
And it must last for at least 10 seconds and be associated with decrease in blood oxygenation on also. Okay. Also.
And the hypopneas, what is the difference? If the apneas is pauses and the hypopneas is?
No, is
shallow, yeah, shallow.
Shallow problems.
Or decrease in breathing, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. We will move to Dr. Tiar as a method and critical appraisal reviewer. Okay, Dr. Tiar, you have your time.
Yes, thank you for the opportunity. I'd like to give comment about this journal. It's a good journal because they want to find the predictor of LPR and OSA. And what I want to confirm is about when I read this journal, they said that the author put the exclusion criteria anything related to the esophageal the therapy or the treatment to the author mention about the reason they put it as the exclusion criteria is the first question from me. The second question, in this journal, they use scoring RSI and RFS, and they put in the journal in English version. And what did they give to the sample in their country? Because the journal is located in Brazil. And I think the what I want to clarify also is about the table number 3 and number 4. They talk about the predictor for LPR, but the result is different. Can you give argumentation about that, Dr. Yudis? Thank you very much.
Thank you for the question from Dr. Tiar. I will try to answer the question. From the first question is the excluding criteria from this journal. The author tells the excluding criteria such as the PPI usage and esophageal surgery and psychiatric disease, alcohol users, and also drug examination or and the esophageal for esophageal. And in this journal, the author, I think they exclude those criteria because to avoid the bias in the study. It is mentioned in a previous study by Belavsky to avoid the bias in the study. And for the second question, in this journal, using the criteria NRSI and NRFS in Brazil, they using in this journal the before statistical analysis, it using Brazilian language and validated. And for the third question, the between in the table 3 and for the RSI and RFS, from that table is using when we get from the table 3 is to know the what factor and how big it is, and that can cause the RSI or RFS can be positive of this journal. From the sample, this journal get 64.3% of the sample. And for the table 4, it tells us about the how can the make the RFS and RSI can be positive. And that's the difference.
Okay, Dr. Yar, is there any comment? I guess you should show your PowerPoint, yeah, Dr. Yudis, as you explain about the table, yeah, because the audience cannot see very enough what the table content. Yeah, this table, 3 and 4. Oke, okay, Dr. Tiar.
Yes, I think for the two question, maybe that's clear enough. And it's mentioned in the journal, but number the last question, maybe we need more explanation about it, Doctor.
And you, apa? Dapat diulang nggak untuk pertanyaan nomor 4 tadi? Ya, untuk yang terakhir.
Why the table 3 and table 4 they compare the variable is the same and but the result is different. In the table 3 they said that the BMI is statistically significant, but in the table 4 there is no variable it's significant.
There's differences, yeah.
I cannot catch the question. Do you think the table 3 and table 4 is the same variable? Dr. Tia?
I think the difference is the word or and the word and, RFS yeah. Or RSE.
Yes, there's a differences from this from both of the table 3 and table 4. The table 3 mentioned the one variable positive RSI or positive RFS. But table 4 is for the both of RFS and RSI, so it is very different, I think. Yeah.
So the result is different, yeah, Dr. Ganti.
Yeah, of course the result is different. So the question is.
Yeah, I think that's answer my question, Doctor. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. So Dr. Yudis. Should we continue for Dr. Gagdo? The last but the not the least important, less important for the writing ya.
Yes, dokter.
Oke, okay, yeah. Literatur.
Ya. Yeah. Thank you, dokter. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for the opportunity. Allow me to give my writing and translation review. Before I want to share screen my okay from this writing, I want to review a little. First, in the page one, there is a term obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. That is, it is a foreign term, and in the Vancouver style, it should, if no translation is available, the foreign term should be type italic. So it should be type in it italic. And second, the word sphincter, that is, it is still in its foreign term. And in Bahasa, it should be translated into sphincter. And UAS, that is, it is abbreviation. Translation should be done, that is foreign term written italic in its original term and in the brackets. So when it is translation sphincter esophagus bagian atas, should be written open bracket upper esophageal sphincter comma UES close bracket.
In English, ya. Yeah.
And the next, in the page 8, we found here extra esophageal. It in Bahasa it should X. It should be written X A K S. Yeah, and then the station in Vancouver style. And the citation should be written superscript in here. And this is the same. The foreign term should be written italic or be translated into ahli laryngology. And the last, I want to my comment in references. In reference number 6, BRAS, this abbreviation, it should be BRAS G otolaryngol. That is, thank you, Doctor.
I think for the translation, a lot of false abbreviation, yeah, Dr. Dagdo, yeah. You can see a lot of false abbreviation. Banyak singkatan yang salah ya tadi. Harusnya di bahasa Inggris kan, should be abbreviation in English, but Dr. Yudis translate the apa in Indonesian, but the abbreviation in English. Okay, Dr. Yudis, you should pay more attention and more detail about the translation. Perhaps you should read not only once after you done your translation, or you can ask your friends for do some correction about the translation, so the translation could be better. Okay, thank you, Dr. Dadu, for the such of a detailed reviewer. For now, we have Dr. Farokah for the supervisor. Okay, dokter.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Nur Iman. The student is Dr. Yudi Chus is good, yeah, this study because critical appraisal, yes, all. And this study, good idea for study president in our department, because applicable, feasible, dan reliable in our department. I want to ask to Dr. Yudis to not difficult your answer. Will you explain definition different or mean between predictor and risk factor? It's one and two. Obesity as an important risk factor. Both disease, OSA and LPR. Why? And three. Patient OSA with using CPAP for the last 3 months were excluded in study. Enough.
Okay.
Thank you, doctor, for the question. I'm sorry, doctor, for the first question.
This question, do you explain different between predictor and risk factor? In study.
Yes,
in this study. Do you explain definition?
In yes, doctor.
For risk factor and predictor.
Yes, doctor. I'm trying to answer the question. I found the question. In this journal, they mention about the predictor of the LPR itself. There is the age and the body mass index and the gender, and also the apnea-hypopnea index and the saturation of the oxyhemoglobin, doctor. And for the predictors, in this journal, it mentioned that the body mass index is the one of the most predictor for the OSA for the NLPR2. And for the obesity is a risk factor of NLPR. From this journal, they can relate it between obesity and the OSA and LPR, because the obesity, it means the score of body mass index is also in higher. Because of that, the patient can relate it having obstructive sleep apnea problems and also the LPR problems. And for the excluded criteria, in this journal, they mention about the patient already using continuous positive airway or CPAP for the last 3 months was excluded. In this journal, they didn't mention the reason, but I think the CPAP itself and also for the OSA in therapy for the OSA, because they didn't using the patient with CPAP.
Question two.
Yes, doctor, for the question number two.
Can you explain?
Pathophysiology.
Question two.
Correlation between
obesity and important factor both disease. Why? Do you answer simple?
The question.
This journal.
Yes.
Mention.
Yeah. I'm starting to answer, doctor. From this journal is tells about the obesity patient has a risk factor of OSA and LPR because of the increasing the body mass index value, doctor. And for the pathogenesis of obesity can be risk factor of OSAs and LPR when they in
intra-abdomen.
In obese patient from the intra-abdomen, in can be using more reflux problems in
peningkatan tekanan intra-abdomen yang LPR-nya karena obesitas. Ya.
Yeah. Yes, dokter.
Enough.
Oke. Okay. For Dr. Kanti. Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Nur Iman. Thank you, Dr. Farok. For the question from Dr. Faroka, I think because the obesity is very, very one of a big predictor for obstructive sleep apnea and LPR2 because of fat deposit tissue in upper airway respiratory tract, and then like Dr. Faruka said before, it will increase the abdominal pressure, so it can make the LPR will be increased in OSAS patient too, anything like that. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Nur Iman.
It's a good idea for study in our department.
Yeah.
Who's resident?
Resident
siapa yang berminat mau penelitian ini? Ini sangat-sangat bagus kalau bisa menggunakan PSG yang ada di rumah sakit. Karena memang perlu jelas untuk stadium atau derajat OSA sedang beratnya harus jelas. Jadi tidak bisa menggunakan PSG yang sederhana. Harus PSG yang multi-channel ya, yang lebih lengkap seperti yang ada di Karyadi. Sebenarnya OSA banyak, sangat-sangat banyak pasiennya ya. Langsung disilakan, tergantung sebagai pembimbingnya siapa, bisa langsung disuruh buat aja, karena mungkin butuh waktu lama ya. Butuh waktu lama ya, untuk indikan pasiennya, karena PSG kan antri.
Jadi dokter.
Ya kalau ya, seminggu bisa 3 pasien, butuhnya berapa pasien kan mungkin agak mungkin ya, ya RSI RFS-nya bisa tidak sama plek ini, mungkin diagnostisnya mau ditambah apa.
Betul. Ini juga tadi kan ada pertanyaan kenapa kok nggak dipakai pH monitoring, kenapa hanya RSI sama RFS? Sebenarnya di jurnalnya juga sudah disebutkan ya Pak Yudis bahwa dari penulisnya, dari penelitinya tidak menggunakan, walaupun dia bilang ini adalah limitation-nya, adalah keterbatasan dari penelitian ini, namun memang untuk pH monitoring itu diketahui baru mendetek hanya yang bersifat asam, tapi tidak untuk yang alkali, padahal bisa juga mengaruhi untuk penderita-penderita LPR, sehingga menurut mereka dengan penggunaan RSI dan RFS saja cukup gitu ya Pak Yudis ya. Dan tadi ada perbedaan ya, juga
RSI-nya masuk. Kalau penelitian di Karyadi misalnya RSI-nya masuk, sudah ada indikasi untuk dilakukan full. Jadi ya, semua pasien bisa pakai BPJS. PSG juga bisa pakai BPJS ya. Langsung ya, aja untuk nanti.
Mudah sekali ya dok, harusnya ya dok
dengan RSI. Sangat-sangat simpel, cuman kan hasilnya bagus, maksudnya bisa applicable
ya,
untuk dilaksanakan ya.
Ya, moga-moga COVID-nya juga selesai ya dok ya, jadi pasiennya ya,
balik lagi. Paling tidak proposalnya dulu.
Proposal lain dulu lah. Iya, oh, enggak dok. Untuk penentuan ini mungkin yang berkaitan dengan itu ya dok ya, mereka masuk stase apa pertama kali ya dok ya? Ya penentuan oh, ya. Bagian apa
penelitian? Silahkan ditelusur, residennya ditelusur.
Ya dok, ya dok, makasih banyak dok.
Ya oke, okay. Selanjutnya Handa. Saya langsung Handa nih, moderatornya ya. Ganti pak.
Dilanjutkan ya dok ya, for the next.
Moderatornya siapa?
Tetap saya dok.
Tetap, ayo lanjut yuk. Yeah.